geometry of non linear surfaces. And the picture we had was an out of space time, so it is good that we have a space time.
Curvature without getting into issues of rigid coefficients, frames, and so on and so forth.
And that has to do with now geometry. And here, of course, we had structure equations, non-structure equations. They require foliation which is null. So in particular, I said the dominant foliation, or a foliation between foliation like in the Savinkov-Nikoski space between a time function, so the foliation given by t, which is space-like, and one given by u, which is null. So an optical function. Or a time function, and together they give you the dominant foliation. And then again, you have these sort of equations, and they are actually useful because once you have estimates for the curvature, so the way this works is that once you have estimates for the curvature, you also get estimates for these sort of things. Okay. Now, the results that I want to talk about now do more than this. So, you see here you have essentially, this is sort of a classical theory in that you are using just energy estimates and somehow infinity estimates are obtained by solid inequalities. Of course, there are more fancy versions of solid inequalities because they require weights and symmetries or quasi-symmetries of the space you want to construct and so on and so forth. But now, the sort of results that I'm presenting now are requiring something else which is called the paralogism. So this is something quite different because you want to construct a representation now of solutions of these type of equations, like for example the equations that we have here, these Bianchi equations. And of course the starting point of this is just the fact that if I have the wave equation, now that's what I got to zero in Minkowski space, so this is in R3 plus 1. Then we have a representation formula, which is Kirchhoff. So this is a formula in physical space. So this is a physical space. And of course there is another one, which is based on plane waves. Plane wave, or Fourier transform, plane waves. So which is based on Fourier transform. And the sort of things that I'm going to discuss today are based on such representations, but of course in this much more complicated situation of a curved space now. Okay, so, and you are not going to construct exact solutions like in this case. You will only construct approximate solutions, but it will turn out that the approximate solutions are good enough to extract lots of information. Okay, so that's sort of the general philosophy. And so for the breakdown criterion, this is what you need, and for the bounded layer 2 curvature, this is what you need. So it's one of these two. Okay, so now, so I talked a little bit about the breakdown criterion last time, at the end of last time, but I won't go fast, so let me say a few more words. Let me go into a little bit more details. So you have a space time here, which is, foliated by a t function. So these are, so you start out at t equals 0, and you have foliation by t equals constant. So there are two possibilities. The magic, of course, can be written in terms of a lapse. So you have the lapse function and the induced metric, which is GIJ, so induced metric on the foliation. And you have two possible foliations that we consider. Either trace k equal to 0, which is a maximal foliation, or trace k equal to t, which will correspond to constant curvature foliation. So the constant curvature foliation is more useful in cosmological settings. So I'm mostly going to talk about the maximal foliation. So let's imagine that we are the maximal case, so we are in asymptotically flat regime. And okay. Fine, so this is a setting, and the theorem tells you that a space time, you see, obviously I can always prove a local existence result. So this is, for example, the result of Sergiu. Well, we discussed it. So
you can always prove some result. And the question is, can I continue? Of course, in general relativity, we know all know that singularities can occur. You cannot expect, you cannot possibly expect to have a global existence result. The general understanding of singularity is very far off. Cosmic censorship, all these are very complicated. So we want to make sort of some steps in the direction of, say, cosmic censorship. And cosmic censorship, you remember when we discussed about it, it's really a regularity. You want to prove regularity outside the domain of outer communication, in the domain of outer communication. So there is a boundary, which is that one of the horizon, and outside this boundary is everything should be smooth. So particularly, you would like to understand when solutions of the Einstein equations are smooth, and that could be given by this type of breakdown criteria. You want optimal breakdown criteria. So in this case, what you do is you take T to be the unit normal to the foliation, so you take this as a vector field, which is well defined, given the foliation, and I take the deformation tensor, right? In other words, I take VT of the space dimension, this is what you call YT, and you take the infinity norm and integrate in time. And the breakdown criterion tells you that if I have a T star here, and if this integral is finite, then the space time can be continued in time. There are no singularities, and I can continue. So as long as this breakdown criterion, as long as this star is satisfied, there can be no singularities.
And still, you need us to put it plus, I think, or more?
Yeah, so this will work in both cases, but let's talk about the asymptotic effect next time. Right? But it will also work in the maximum case, right? Or maximum. Sorry, for the CNC. Okay, so this is the result, and of course this pi t, I should say, depends on the second fundamental form, right? So pi t is expressed purely in terms of the second fundamental form of the foliation, so let's call it k, and the derivative of the Laplace function n. Okay, that's all. It don't depend on this. Okay. Now here are some results which were known before our result. So Anderson, 2001, proved that if curvature is bounded at infinity, then no singularities can form. So if I know that the Riemann curvature tensor is bounded here, then I can extend. Observe that our result is much better because it's at the level of just one derivative of the curvature, rather than two derivatives of the curvature. And of course, it's also expressed just in terms of the deformation tensor. It's very geometric in the sense that it's expressed just in terms of the deformation tensor of one vector field. So, particularly this measures, this vector field measures how far away you are from the plot. Okay, so it's a very natural geometric condition. There is, of course, a result, I mentioned earlier about this. There is an Euler, big cutoff minor result for the Euler incompressive Euler equations, which tell you it's very similar in the sense that if I have any information about the curl, which is a physical quantity that corresponds to vorticity, if the vorticity of a fluid is bounded in an infinity discussion, then no singularities can form. And there is this other result of Ferdinand Moncrief that can be no breakdown. So this is actually a global regularity result for young fields. And in fact, the result that we have is actually somewhat similar. This is a result in flat space, so it's much simpler, but sort of the general philosophy is not that different. Okay, so let's go on. Okay, so what are the main steps? Well, it turns out, and I explained it last time, that once I have the criterion, star is the criterion, right? Once the criterion is true, it's very easy to get curvature bounded in a 2 of sigma t. So it's very easy to get these bounds. This is just the energy estimate for this Bell-Robinson tensor associated. Right, so as you know, there is a Bell-Robinson tensor associated with these equations, and you just apply it immediately follows that curvature is bounded. In fact, of course, when you prove that you have curvature bounding in L2 on this, you also prove curvature bounds for the flux. You also show that the flux is affine, right? So that's very important, right? As we shall see. Okay, so now the Next observation is that, of course, it's not enough to show curvature is bounded in L2. I need much more. I need what are called derivatives of curvature. And it's easy to see that if I also have information about the Riemann curvature in L infinity, then I get derivatives of curvature. But the issue is how to prove that this L infinity bounds. So the major question is how to prove L infinity bounds. Once I have L infinity bounds, I have everything else. Okay, so and observe that this is exactly what Andersen assumes, and this is what we have to prove. Alright, so okay, so as I said, steps 1 and 2 are based on energy time estimates. And step 3, which is this curvature bounded at infinity, is based on this Kirchhoff formula, or Kirchhoff somewhere in the case where you are in a curved space time. And the starting point, as I said last time, is just this wave equation for the curvature. So the curvature tensor is a wave equation. And now, what we did last time was to pretend that this G here is actually the flat metric. And then I can apply the usual formula. I can apply the usual formula for the fundamental solution in physical space. The usual Kirchhoff formula, which is expressed, it's exactly the one here. And with some structural condition satisfied here, I was able to bound everything in terms of the flux of curvature and conclude that you get the infinity bound. So anyway, I mean, you can schematically redo what I did last time by looking at this model equation that I mentioned by psi squared, because it looks very much like this. Except that it doesn't have the structure that this one has. And in fact, this doesn't have global solutions. But nevertheless, I can think of it in terms of what might be wrong. And well, you represent using the fundamental solution, if you represent it like this, with an R minus 1 phi squared, this is an outcome from the point P, so it's a darker light cone. And if you remember last time, what we did is that we took the L2 norm on the light cone of R minus 1. We took an L infinity norm of phi. We are trying to buy to estimate the L infinity norm of phi here. We have the L infinity norm of phi also here. And the remaining part will be an L2 norm of phi on the outcome. Of course, in this particular case, it's exactly this that will be bad, because integral of phi squared is not allowed. Integral of the outcome of phi squared is not finite. It cannot be expressed in terms of the quantities that I want to bound here. And I don't have bounds of this type. And because of this, in fact, this breaks down. Okay? Now, what's special here is that I can always take a term, one of the two terms, can always be taken as a flux of the curvature. So it can be taken as flux, and therefore, since the flux of curvature, I know that it's bounded, I can compare. Okay, so this is what happens if you cheat here and you use this you assume that this is actually the flat metric, which of course is wrong, but turns out that you can make it work. So the idea is to express the fundamental solution of this equation. Talking about the equation dimension of R, is R plus R. So the idea is to get a representation which is very similar to the representation in physical space, in Minkowski space. Right? So in other words, I'm going to claim that this is going to be an integral over the null cone, but this is not the correct null cone. So the correct null cone for the correct metric, right? And here I'm going to have R cross R, which is this term. And I'm going to put this weight, which was 1 over R before, I'm going to put it here. I don't know what it is, but hopefully we can find something out. And then there will be some error term. And the error term turns out, as we'll see, that it also can be written as some W, so this corresponds to an error. Which is zero, so this term will be zero in Minkowski space times the curvature term, and it's again an integral over the light cone. This is quite remarkable that you can get the error term also expressed in terms of an integral over the light cone. to the point B. Alright, so then once you have this, you proceed exactly like we did last time. That's how you estimate the first part in terms of curvature in an infinity. This is a weight which plays a role of 1 over r. Okay? So, and now you get this type of norm. And here you get the flux of curvature, which comes from the fact that at least one component of the curvature can be put in the flux. Okay? So this uses, again, this uses the structure of the Eilenberg equations. Okay? Otherwise, it's certainly not true. So this is a flux step, which corresponds to the tangential derivatives. And now you see that if you can also show that this quantity is small, if you take the picture like this, so say I'm at time zero, and I go to time epsilon, let's say. So if I know that this distance is not too large, then this quantity is going to be small. And therefore, I can absorb the infinity. So I'm estimating the infinity norm. I can absorb the infinity norm here and do the infinity norm there, and I get the closure. And I conclude that the infinity norm for this time, and this would be a universal constant, depends only on the flux of curvature. Okay, so the flux of curvature is bounded, everything is okay. So that's the idea. Alright, so. Okay. So then here is a remark that the flux of curvature is also bounded when I do energy estimates. So when I did the energy estimates at the beginning, using the criterion, so this was the breakdown criterion, then in fact I also get the flux. And so that's a universal bound. Okay. So and here is the final estimate. As you see, you have estimated infinity norm in terms of an initial data. I0 refers to some initial data, so it doesn't matter, it's something fixed. Plus flux of curvature, which is R0, so it's just the flux of the initial data, but it's actually, sorry, it's just an initial data now. R0 corresponds to just initial data. And delta 0 is just exactly this sort of thing, which is supposed to be small. And therefore, if delta 0 is sufficiently small, you can absorb the Riemann and infinity norm, and so it on the left. Okay, of course, all this depends on these bounds. I mean, in particular, I need a bound for this, because remember that we took the L2 norm of W on the right one, and I need an estimate for this error. The W was the error, which was, it's going to be kind of complicated. And we have to estimate these things in terms of just delta 0 to 1 half, or some function of the flux. So what are the difficulties? Well, we need this appropriate parameter. I have to construct these parametrics. So I have to find the little W and the capital W, and of course they are going to be complicated. We need to obviously to control the geometry of characteristic hypersurfaces. And now here comes up an application of what we did last time, because obviously, I need these light cones to make sense, at least for that long a period of time. Right? In other words, I need to control the geometry of these null hypersurfaces, knowing that the only thing I have is flux of curvature. Because the flux is bounded, we have proved, right? I mean, this falls on the energy. So the flux is bounded, and therefore, now I hope also to control the geometry. And here I have to use everything that we did last time. It's slightly, it's actually, we have to modify things a little bit because it's not done, this is not done relative to the affine parameter as it was done last time, but everything has to be done now relative to the foliation given by T. Okay? Because the section of steep or constant with the light on will give you a different foliation. But this is not such a big thing. It can be done. Of course, the second parameter form also will play a role and so on. So, there is quite a lot of technical details, but in principle, the geometry will be controlled exactly like before. Of course, there is also the issue of radius of injectivity. But yeah. Okay. Once you have this, you also need sharp estimates for this quantity. And again, the only thing we have is curvature flux bound. Okay. All right, so here I recall very fast the Kirchhoff formula, how do you derive the Kirchhoff formula in flat space? We did it actually at the beginning of the series of lectures. So you take the solution in the form of W times delta, this is W times delta of U. So this is the delta function supported, right? So it's a delta function supported on the line on U equal zero. So this is the distribution which makes very much sense. U in the case of flat space would be t plus epsilon bar of x, which corresponds exactly t plus epsilon bar of x equal to 0 is exactly this line. And w will be wx to the minus 1, but in fact you can actually deduce it. And indeed, this is a calculation that we already did last time. If you calculate the dimension of this quantity, you get this times this, plus this times this, you get all sorts of derivatives. And because of the Eilenberg equation, because U is a solution of the Eilenberg equation, this term is zero. This is the most dangerous term involving two derivatives. And this one also has to be zero in order to get rid of delta prime. In fact, it is zero. It's very easy to see. And if you take W to be the absolute value of this position minus one, this will be zero. And finally, you are left with this. W, in other words, this term, and W is just the dimension of 1 over r, means Laplacian of 1 over r, which is a delta function on t equal constant, multiplied with delta function on t plus absolute value x equal to 0. This is just the usual delta function. So this is how you prove it. So you have to solve the Eilenberg equation. So you have to solve this Eilenberg equation, which is true because U verifies U is actually explicit, and you have to verify a transport equation where W is even you can see what W would correspond, observe that this quantity here is actually 2 over R. So when I calculate the equation of t plus up to the fix, I get exactly 2 over r, which by the way is the trace of the non-second fundamental form of this light bulb. So this is exactly the trace of the non-second fundamental. Okay, good. So this is what it is. Okay, so now you want to repeat the same calculation in a curved space time. So again, U has to be a solution of the Eilenberg equation, and W I don't know, I would have to find. I redo the same calculation. I see that this term will be zero. I want to make this term equal to zero also. I observe that the dimension of U is actually the trace of pi, so trace of the non-second fundamental form. And it's something that I can do. However, now, when I do that, I cannot make this to be basic. So I cannot get this to be just a delta function. The only thing I can hope for, this we'll see on the next slides, the only thing I can hope for is to make this to be the delta function at the point P with an error term. So there will be an error term. And the error is kind of complicated because it's going to depend on two derivatives of trace chi, for example, and many other things. Okay. But it has this nice feature that it's always multiplied by delta. Okay, so in other words, the final result will be a result in which pi, right, so I'm looking at a solution of the wave equation, the dimension of pi is f, which is up there, and you have the phi at the point P expressed in terms of W times f, evaluated over the life cone with a weight which corresponds to that 1 over r, plus another term, which again is concentrated on just an hypersurface through P, so which is a very nice feature. And finally, W is a complicated expression which involves all sorts of things. And W also is not so simple because you get W from that equation. So you get U over DSW plus W plus that. So it satisfies the transport equation along, W satisfies the transport equation along these non-geodesics of the null amount. Everything is done starting from a point. Okay. So
the geometry now is actually the geometry of an alpha set.
Oh, yeah.
And I'm looking at the backward light on because this is what happens in the formula.
Okay. Alright, so the point here is theorem number one, n minus p is free of intersecting non-geodesics, and the radius of injectivity is bounded below by a universal constant. This is morally what we did last time, except that last time we only talked about radius of conjugacy, now I also have to talk about radius of injectivity. In other words, I have to talk about, I have to exclude cut locus points. And of course, when you exclude cut locus points, I need information not just on the light cone, I need information about also the foliation, okay, which is given by the C. So anyway, so this is something that can be done. It's not much more difficult than what I discussed last time. In fact, the radius of conjugacy is much more complicated from an analytic point of view. The card locus issue is much simpler. But in any case, it requires an argument. And this is what it is. So the theorem 1 and 2 give you the radius of injectivity. And of course, you have many other issues. It should be Hodge here. This is what we discussed. In order to get bounds on the radius of injectivity, we need Hodge system, combined transport equations. We need this sharp S of tracer and on all type of surfaces. We have to use a full structure of the Einstein equations many, many times in many ways, not just the Einstein equation, but everything in time. And we have to use we have to introduce this geometry leading valet theory, and then we have to so this is what we discussed last time. So obviously this does not give you a whole proof, but it gives you all the ingredients in the proof of the breakdown idea. Okay, so that's as far as I wanted to say about breakdown criterion. Now let's ask some questions. I'll go on to the bounded. So this was an example of a parametrics which corresponds to the physical space parametrics of the wave equation. Right? So it is. So everything is happening in physical space. Now what I'm going to do next will require is other parametrics, which is based on Fourier transform. Okay, so let's talk now about the boundary. Right, so I start up with an introduction. And then I'll move to the main ideas. But let me first of all tell you what this conjecture is. So we have introduction. So we are looking, of course, at Ricci flat. We have initial data sets with constraints, so the usual constraint equations, and the classical local existence result tells you that. If I start up with a metric G, right, the initial metric G, which is Riemannian, and which is in HS log, right? So it's in HS meaning there are S derivatives in L2 of sigma naught and localized to domains of sigma naught. And the second fundamental form belongs to HS minus 1. And F is strictly larger than 5 half, so this is an important number. Then there exists only in spacetime. And the embedding of the initial data set into the space time such that G and K becomes the first and second fundamental form. So this is what's called the development of the initial data set. This is a result which is essentially proved by Yvonne Chokebu. I say essentially because she definitely doesn't get the sharp 5 half. She gets the, I don't know, she used 4 derivatives or something. All right. So the sharp result was obtained much later. Okay, and it was based, the result was based on wave coordinates, which I have explained many times. If you use wave coordinates, then you get a system of wave equations, and you can apply the theory of nonlinear wave equations in order to prove the result. You can look at this model equation, which was this. Dimension of phi is a function which depends on phi, the derivatives of phi. And then you can see what you need in order to prove local existence. And well, there are energy estimates and incompletions. combined with some normal inequality and interpolation inequality. Anyway, these are just energy estimates, just standard energy estimates. You just integrate by parts many times, you are careful a little bit how distribute the derivatives. Anyway, at the end of the day, you can show that the HS norm, so this is the HS norm of phi, so looking at HS norm at time t, is bounded by the HS norm at time 0 times this exponential of derivative of phi to infinity. And then you use a solid inequality to go from an infinity to HS, and when you do somewhere, you use phi half. Then you do once you have now phi half here, right? You pick up to be phi half. This is phi half. This becomes phi half after you apply this. Then you see that you can get a contraction if the time is sufficiently small, and you see this by doing an iteration scheme. Everything, everybody knows. So this is a big iteration scheme. Okay. So now the issue is this local existence result is very is not very good. And in fact, you would like to get a sharp result. And why do you want to get a sharp result? I mean, for many people here are in analytic surveys, so for you it's very easy to understand. Usually people will ask me why it would be better, but people in analytic survey understand that in order to get a global regularity result, the first thing you have to do is some kind of epsilon regularity result. So you need a critical norm, some critical norm, which if it's small, if the critical expansion is small, you have regularity. So something that measures the least amount of so it's a norm which controls the least amount of regularity which is needed in order to get start getting something which is connected, which can be connected later on to lower regularity. Okay, so from this point of view, the critical exponent is three half. So if you think about what would you need to implement this epsilon regularity result, you see that what you need is SC is equal to 3 half. Right, so now the question, can you prove world positiveness for this critical exponent? Hugely difficult question, the answer of which we don't know. It's most probably expressed in this framework is most probably wrong, and that's what I want to talk about. Okay. Now, this kind of critical world positiveness results are fundamental in all of nonlinear PDEs, in analytic PDEs, but also in hyperbolic PDEs. So, for example, there are famous results on conservation laws in 1 plus 1 dimension. So all the results that are known today are in 1 plus 1 dimension. In 1 plus 1 dimension, there is an incredible simplification of the theory because you don't have to work in L2 anymore. You can work in L1 spaces, L1 type spaces like BV. So there's a well-established theory in BV norms, and BV norms are, in fact, critical relative conservation. Okay. So this is one case in which this criticality has been achieved, and it has led to very good results globally. By the way, if you get a result for the critical exponent, if you get a local exact for the critical exponent, it's not automatically global. Of course, it will require a smallness of the initial data in that critical exponent. Right. So now, it's well known for a long time now, for the last 50 years, that these kind of BV norms have no chance to work in high dimensions because they are not even preserved locally by solution of linear wave equations. Okay, so they are terrible norms in high dimensions. So you need something else. And the only thing we have, as I explained many times in this course, the only thing we have are energy estimates. The only thing that is preserved, this local flow, are only the energy estimates, which means you have to work in empty spaces. Okay, so now the point here is, which I want to make, is that somehow quasi-linear wave equations in higher dimensions have another much more subtle scaling, which is a parabolic scaling associated with the cycle equation. And this we already have seen
we have already have seen that that somehow, in order to control the geometry of a non-hypersurface, I need at least the flux, which is an L2 norm of curvature. So this is an L2 norm of R. So this is at the level of HS with S equal to 2. And you cannot go below it. I mean, we saw that the geometry, as I explained last time, the geometry cannot be controlled if I have less than this. I mean, this result was already shocked, absolutely, I mean, completely shocked, in fact. And in fact, you know, we had to squeeze quite a bit. We had to work with less of nodes and so on and so forth, just to squeeze this result. So anything less than 2 will hit this problem of non-hypersurfaces. Non-hypersurfaces are ill-defined if I have less than 2. So this is an issue that only works for quaternary equations. So this is an issue that we only see for quaternary equations. If you have geometric semi-linear equations like Young-Mills or wave maps, that's not an issue because diagonal equation does not exist. Diagonal equation is trivial. Okay? And that's why people could go for geometric semi-linear equations. People could actually go all the way to the critical exponent. So in fact, there have been some incredible progress in recent years, where you could really achieve the critical exponent in some cases. For example, you can achieve the critical exponent for wave maps in two dimensions. This is a famous result by people. And recently, people seem to be able to get the optimal result for Maxwell-Kai-Golden in 4 plus 1 dimension. And anyways, there has been a lot of activity exactly around this issue, how to get the critical exponent. So, semi-linear equations, you can do it, or you can hope to do it. It's not yet done in all cases. I mean, certainly for Young-Mills it's not done. And there are other cases where it's not done. But at least you can hope to go all the way to the critical exponent. But not for quasi-linear equations. Okay, so now, what can you do? There are some improvements that you can do based on Strieber's inequality. So, Strieber's inequality is very simple to explain. If I have a solution of, let's take the version of I equal to 0 in Minkowski space. This is the simplest case. So suppose we are in Strieber's one dimension. Right? So that term, in the Strieber's inequality, that term goes away. And you see that I can estimate integral from 0 to t of the infinity norm of I in terms of hs minus 1 norm of the first derivative of phi, where s is strictly larger than 1. In other words, I need 1 plus epsilon derivative of initial phi times 0 in order to estimate the integral of phi derivative. This is clearly better than what I would get by Sobolev estimate, because the Sobolev will require 3 half. So this is where you gain, if you use a 3 half, you gain half a derivative because of the integration in time. So this is sort of a very major issue in harmonic analysis. This type of Strieber's estimates are tied to modern harmonic analysis based on restrictions, theorems, and so on and so forth. But you know, it's not more than just this. You just gain half a derivative because of integration of time. That's the only thing you have to remember. Okay? I never remember the full range of Strieber's inequalities anyway. But I do remember this one. That you can squeeze half a derivative by using integration in time. Okay, very good. Now, it turns out that you can use these estimates for equations like this, which are very much like wave equation, except that now the metric is flat, right? So you have just that version of time. The scaling for this equation is exactly the same as for the Einstein equation. And so if I'm in Strieber's one dimension, I can go using Strieber's inequality, I can go to s bigger than 2 because I gain half a derivative for 5 half to 2, I gain exactly half. But I cannot go to s equal to 2. And in fact, there are counterexamples, as we shall see in a second. So now, the same result for quasi-linear equation is much more complicated. Because now I cannot apply that kind of Strieber's inequality. The naive Strieber's inequality does not work anymore. I have to do a Strieber's inequality for in a curved metric, and of course that means that somehow I need a Strieber's inequality in a
space-time where the metric itself is very rough, because it has to be rough at the same level as what I'm trying to prove, right? So clearly it's much more complicated, but in any case it can be done, and it turns out that these results have been extended to quasi-linear wave equations, which are of the type that are needed for the Einstein equations, and the best results are due to Rodnyansky and myself, and the first results were due to Bahuri and Shemal, and then Tataru, and then Rodnyansky and myself, which improved on this, and then the optimal one were achieved with S strictly larger than 2 by Rodnyansky and myself, and Mr. Tataru. And they are quite complicated technically, but in any case, hopefully, we don't need them anymore because we can do better. So the result is sharp for general equations. So in other words, you can prove that you can never go to S equal to 2 if I have a general equation. So for example, if I have an equation like this, the only thing you can do is prove well both an estimation plus 1. It's imposing issue. So that means, what this means is that the structure of the Einstein equations or any other quasi-linear equation you have has to be very important if you are to get S equal to 2. Okay? Right. So that's the boundary theorem 2 is exactly the understanding that in principle you could go all the way to S equal to 2. And this 2 is in between 5.5 and 3.5. There's still a room of 1.5. Okay? But this is the best we can do in time. Because of what I said earlier, that, because of the issue of non-hypersurfaces, this is the best that we can do. And before we all go inside. So let me emphasize that this uses such a result has to use a special structure of the Einstein equation. And it also should be viewed as a breakdown criterion. I don't care about how rough the data is really. All I care is that I can extend the solution as long as its norms remain bounded. In other words, as long as you have two norms of the result of course can be expressed geometrically, since I'm at the level of two derivatives of the metric, can be expressed in terms of just coverage of the metric, g initial data, and the first derivative of the second fundamental form. So all I need is a better L powers on this distance. Right. So this should be viewed as a breakdown criterion. In other words, the space-time together with the well-chosen platform region can be extended as long as the estimate is true. Now, observe that such a result in fact improves the result that I discussed earlier. Right? Because this result, if you remember, if you have this, I can prove an L2 bound for the curvature. But if I can prove L2 bound for the curvature and I have the conjecture verified, then I can extend the solution as long as that is. I don't need the estimates of any infinity norm curvature. I can just extend it. So this is clearly much stronger. This breakdown, this conjecture, this bounded L2 curvature conjecture is clearly much stronger than the result which I just showed. But it's very instructive to see how you get two different proofs of this type of second breakdown criterion. One which is a valid proof in physical space, and the other one uses space. Okay, so what are the difficulties? The first major difficulty is that you cannot use wave coordinates like in the result of the Monchon equation. If you do that, you are totally lost because you don't see the structure of the structure of the Einstein equation has to be fundamental if you are to go to S equal. So you have to dig much further, and you cannot use the wave coordinates. Second problem is that we need approximate solutions because even the result of Strickland's estimates, as larger than 2, requires a representation. You see, I didn't say, but in order to prove Strickland's estimates, you really need a representation. You have to be very careful with what representations of the solutions you are using. In fact, it's is done using Fourier transform representation. You cannot do the Stringhouse estimate. In fact, I challenge anybody to try to prove a Stringhouse estimate directly from the Kirchhoff solver form. Okay? You cannot do it. It has to be the Fourier based form. All these things are very subtle. So some representations are good for some things, other representations are good for something else. So you need approximate solutions, and they have to be different because by the estimate we need something even stronger than Stringhouse estimate. Therefore, I have to use some kind of representations in Fourier space. And obviously, how do you do that? It's a major problem because I have a metric here. I'm not in flat space, so I cannot use a standard Fourier transform. This is going to be a major problem. And finally, we have this geometry of characteristics, but this is already something that we understand. Because I'm at the level of the L2, bounded L2 curvature conjecture implies that I'm only going to use L2 bounds on the curvature. So therefore, the only thing I have are L2 bounds, flux of curvature 2, of course, because it goes to the right. But then, of course, I control the geometry of null hypersurface. We already know. But the null hypersurfaces that I'm going to use now are not these ones, but rather null planes. So I'm going to work with null planes instead. But null planes or null cones are not that different from the point of view of this geometry. Okay. And of course, there is a high level of complexity. Everything comes together, like always. It's quasi-linear problems. All these difficulties hit you at the same time. Find sort of a way to bootstrap. Okay, here is something that I already discussed. In order to do this, I need a Cartan formalism for the Einstein equations. So I go very fast over this because we have already discussed. So we have frames. We start with frames, which are not coordinates. But I'm not doing something anything at the level of coordinates. I do it at the level of frames. Then we have connection 1 forms, which are obtained by taking derivatives of the frame. The Riemann curvature tensor can be expressed in terms of this, which looks very much like a curvature of a Young-Mills cage connection. Then the Young-Mills equations take this form, the vertical form. We have the frame changes. We have changes of frames. Under a change of frame, you get the A's change according to this very standard formula. And then finally, once I know that A is expressed in terms of derivative of A, I can plug it in here, and I get an equation for the A, which looks like a wave equation for the A. Except I have this second term here, which is at the level of two derivatives, which looks like a bad term. And here, of course, we have quadratic terms involving derivatives of A and A itself. And of course, as I already explained many times, the way we deal with this is by picking up a certain condition, which makes it into a well-posed problem. So typically, this is not well-posed unless you make a gauge choice. Right, so what choice to make? Well, first thing to do is to see what you can do in flat space. Okay, so I'm going to look at the Eilenberg equations in flat space, and I start exactly at the level. So what I want to prove is the theorem of Magedon and myself from the 1994. In which we show that the Young-Mills equations are well posed in the energy law, which corresponds to exactly s equal to 1. So this is Young-Mills equation in one part, in four dimensions. And s equal to 1 is s equal to 1 for A, which is at the level of a derivative of the metric if I look at the Einstein equation written as the Young-Mills. Therefore, s equal corresponds exactly to s equal to 2 for the metric. So this is sort of the right. Result in terms of what you want to achieve with the engine. Okay, so that's what you think. All right, so now you make, so we are now in flat space, so the metric here, which came up here, so of course in general I have a metric here, which is
obviously a metric for which I have a very few regularity information.
But in flat space I don't have to worry about this, so this is much easier. What we do in order to deal with this issue of the second order term there is to pick up a Coulomb gauge. So there are other gauges that you can use. You can use also Lorentz gauge. And I think we discussed it at some point. But the Lorentz gauge, if you use, you will not be able to get this equal to 1. At least not the way I'm going to do it here. So in order to get this equal to 1, you really have to use a Coulomb gauge. Okay? So the choice of gauge is very important, because only with the right gauge do you see the structure of the model. Okay, so I'm going to get the equations which look like, first of all, I take di, ai equal to 0. So Coulomb gauge means I have a 0, a 1, a 2, a 3. And I'm taking the condition that b 1, a 1, a 2, a 2. I mean in Euclidean space. So these are all Euclidean derivatives. This is equal to 0. Right, so that's a condition that I have the dIAI equal to 0. As you see, it's easy to see from the equations that we had before. So you just look at these equations, but now use G in the Minkowski metric. And the covariant derivatives are just standard derivatives. And relative to the Coulomb gauge, these equations split into an equation for a zero, which is very easy to see. It's going to be a Laplace equation. So a zero times an analytic equation. And on the right hand side, I have terms like a times derivative of a. And then you have an equation for the AIs, which is a wave equation, so the AI is verified wave equation, but with a coupling with a zero that you get from before, so there's still this ugly term corresponding to another two derivative of A, but it comes up only in this simpler fashion, it comes to a zero. And on the right hand side, we have a bunch of terms, and the only terms that we have to worry about are these terms, because they involve derivative of A times derivative of A. And this is a hyperbolic variable. So the hyperbolic variable is a dangerous one. The elliptic variable, I don't care so much because there is some room. So elliptic estimates, of course, should go all the way to synthetic exponents. So in principle, I can go, if I had only elliptic equations, I could go to 3/2. Okay? And the reason I cannot go to 3/2 is only because of this part. Right? So these terms here are also pretty good because they involve a zero times derivative of A. So I can ignore them, a cube I can ignore, and so on and so forth. So the only thing that I need to worry about are these terms and these terms. And so, okay, so now, how do you do? What do you do? Well, if I forget about the structure of the equation and I look at an equation like this, 5 times derivative of 5, then the best I can do is, again, just h1 plus epsilon. I cannot do any better than this. Again, there are other examples. So if I am to do better, I have to use a special structure of these terms. In other words, I have to use a special structure of these terms. So okay, how do you see that you can use that? Well, the idea is to commute, is to project on the divergence free vector here. So, projection of divergence free vector fields does two beautiful things for you. First of all, it kills this ugly term here because it's a gradient. So it kills that one, which is very good because that is very unpleasant. It has two derivatives. So in principle, it could hurt you. But now, of course, P commutes with the wave operator. We are in Minkowski space, so we are in flat space. P commutes. So I get the diversion of AI. Well, P of AI is equal to AI. That's easy to see, right? Because AI is divergence free. This is divergence free. P because of the block gauge condition. Right? So the, when I conclude, I get exactly the same thing here, and I cube that term. And on the right hand side, I get P of these RV terms plus terms which I consider to be better, so I don't worry about them. Right? So now, you have to show that we can control these most dangerous terms. And now I'm going to see structure again. Okay, so the point now is that there are bilinear estimates which are better than the Strieghardt estimates. So if I only had Strieghardt estimates, I would be dead, but because I would lose an epsilon derivative. So in order to get around the thing, I have to use new estimates, which are called bilinear estimates. And these are estimates that Bateman and I introduced exactly for this kind of reason, is to estimate terms of this stuff. And the idea is that, for example, AI, if I have A, which is divergence 3, and it verifies the wave equation. So you see, if you have divergence of A equal to 0, I can assume in the first approximation that divergence of A is 0, and divergence of I is 0. So in other words, we look at just notion of the homogeneous part. And I take AI times DR phi, and I know that AI is divergence 3. Very important, the result is not true as well. Right? So divergence is essential. Then the claim is that AI DI phi in L2 is estimated by the L2 norm of derivative phi times the D phi L2 norm of derivative phi. And this is exactly at the right level, because DA is exactly H1 norm. And d phi phi corresponds to an a also, so it's also h1 norm of a. So everything is very good. And again, this estimate will be false if you did not assume the divergence of derivatives. Okay, so you the best thing to do in that case would be Strieghardt that uses epsilon derivative. So this takes care of this term. So because you have an AJ, DJ of AI, so it takes care of this. And you don't even need the projection in that case. The projection, of course, is bounded in L2, so I can always take it out. But you don't need it here, so the estimate is just for that. But I need it here. So P of this term also verifies by the estimate. So that's what you see. The second estimate is under the same assumption that A is divergence 3, and let's say divergence of A equals 0, then this bad term can be estimated just in terms of the derivative of A. Okay. Yeah. So that's the second binding estimate. And the proof, the original proof, was very much based on Fourier analysis. In fact, The original proof did was to take, say, AI DI phi. You have to estimate the L2 norm in space-time. So this is R cross R space. So you see, usually Fourier transform for wave equation requires L2 norm of just the spatial values. You don't take L2 in T. Here you take L2 in T. And the idea was that this by Planck-Chorel is the same thing as the space-time Fourier transform of the product, which is can be written as a convolution of things which are supported on light cones in Fourier space. You can calculate the convolution, and you see that there is some cancellation because of the special structure and the fact that A is divergence 3. Okay? So that was the idea. Of course, we cannot do it here. There's no way. I mean, I can do it. I can do it here, but I'm not going to be able to do it in curved space time. Right? So that we'll have to do a completely different proof in curved space time. I'm not sure how much time. How much time can I take? Another.
I don't have the lead early.
Sorry?
I don't have the lead early. For me personally.
Maybe you should let people lead if they want. Maybe I'll take 10 more minutes. Okay, so these are the estimates. And of course, we need now estimates like this in curved space time. So maybe what I'll do, okay, so here I have a proof of bilinear estimates in flat space. But maybe I should try to do this at the end. So let's see how we finish everything, and then I'll come back maybe and I'll go very fast over this. There's one very pretty idea in all this, in the way you prove it, which I want to emphasize. I'm not going to be able to give you the whole gist of the proof, but at least one idea I think I can do. But let me first finish, and then come back on this. Okay, so strategy of the proof of the conjecture. So first thing now. So obviously this result for Young-Mills in flat space, the result we had, is relevant. It's relevant because that was the whole idea of at the beginning. We wanted to reformulate the equation in such a way that I could use the same kind of tricks. We recognize the same type of terms and so on. So that was, so the idea is to use a Young-Mills approach. So you use Young-Mills formulas, the long gauge condition. So these were the three ingredients. Projection apparatus, and of course, binding estimates that needed to be obtained. Okay, so, but now, obviously, in order to prove binding estimates, I will need an approximate parametrics. You will see that the way these binding estimates work, the new proof of binding estimates, we can say. So for example, we have this AI, EI, I. We want to do the F norm. So it turns out that we can reduce this divergence of A is equal to 0. So we can reduce it to another kind of binding estimate, which is QYJ. So this is now the standard null form for two solutions of the wave. So let's say I have the equation of phi, the equation of psi. So this is now just a scalar. Both phi and psi are scalars. And I'm trying to estimate this in a group in terms of H1 norm of one of them times H2 norm of the other one. Okay. So this is the initial data for it. One for the first, and actually for the second. It turns out that if you have this, you can easily prove this one. Okay. So it turns out that this sort of thing, if you introduce for the AI, if you introduce a potential, which will satisfy a wave equation, you go from there. Okay. Now, this one, you see, in order to do this, you see that this is sort of symmetric. It's not symmetric relative to derivatives. So you look at the this psi, in which you are allowed to put more derivatives, and you express it in terms of Fourier representations of psi of E and X. It's an integral of e to the I of psi, e to the I of psi, and half of psi. You see, in fact, you can have here plus or minus, but it doesn't matter. So usually you have a superimposition of terms involving plus and minus, and then it suffices to prove the result for just one of them. So I can just take this. Okay, the proof requires this representation. It doesn't require the phi to be represented. I can use phi as just a solution of the wave equation. What I'm doing, the idea is I'm going to do for phi is to use a flux. So I'm going to use the flux of derivatives of phi, which are tangential, so tangential derivative of phi, integrated over any non-hypersurface, which corresponds to, I can rewrite, let me rewrite this as integral of I lambda u omega. Then lambda squared and part of lambda omega, d lambda d omega. And here there is an integral from 0 to infinity and an integral in lambda, so this is d lambda. And there is an integral on S2 relative to this omega. So this is omega equal to 1. So integrating over phase function. So the phase function, is just right inside is lambda times omega. And this becomes just lambda. So the phase function here is just d plus x plus omega. Now this is a social regular equation. And what I what is used in this body estimate is a flux of I along this null hypersurface is generated by u omega equal constant. So it's a beautiful proof which takes into account the body estimates and produces exactly the flux of curvature of I. So for that reason, phi does not need to be expressed in terms of a parametric. But psi is essential that you have a parameter. So if I, in curves, but space-time, that's exactly what I'm going to do. I'm going to represent the psi by a generalized parametric. I'm not going to express it in terms of the explicit solution of this. It will have to be an approximate solution. That's a parametric idea. And this is what I'm trying to say now, that we need parametrics for solutions of the wave equation. And of course, I also have a right side. That's not very important. Okay. And once I have the parametrics, then I'm going to prove Balin estimates exactly like I do in the flat case. Okay? Except that of course I don't have an explicit representation of the entire solution. Psi is represented, I have this plus an error term. So obviously, I will have at some point, I'll have to estimate the error terms. Okay, so, that's sort of roughly what the idea. So, we need the Biden estimate. Alright, so now let me go very fast over. So, the coordinate issue is solved by doing the Einstein-Wagner equation expressed as a Young Hills. Again, we have to use a Coulomb gauge. And here this is sort of an important point. How do I choose a frame? So the frame, so that's, I have to make a geometric choice for the frame. So remember, okay, so the space-time starts up at equal zero and exfoliated by maximal. I need, just like in the other criteria, in the breakdown criteria, I need a maximal foliation. It has to be maximal. Maximal foliation. That means trace k equal to zero. And therefore, I have a choice for E0. So E0 is an element of the frame, and I can choose it. Then I can also choose E1, E2, E3 here. So they are tangent to sigma t. And I choose them such that they satisfy this Coulomb gauge in that condition. So that's the idea. So it turns out that with this kind of choice, the whole thing satisfies the Coulomb gauge condition. Okay? So that's very important. You have to pick up something which is geometrically meaningful. The equations then become very much, they're exactly like before in this Coulomb gauge, except of course the only difference is that I have the metric here, right? Which is obviously a problem. Then, I have to, the other idea that we have in the flat case is to use a projection operator. Well, I'm going to use a projection operator. But now, there's a big issue, because when I use the projection will kill this term, but it does not commute anymore with the wave operator. So this is a major difficulty which actually kept us worried for a long time, because it's not at all clear that when you project, it may well be that the projection produces bad terms. There's no reason a priori why this should produce only bilinear in terms which satisfies these bilinear conditions, for which we could apply bilinear estimates. So this is quite remarkable that if you express everything relative to the frame, so everything is expressed relative to the frame, the U1, E2, E3, E0. If you express everything to the relative to the frame, and you compute with this operator, you produce things which are only non-forms, but there will have to be non-forms which will only involve curvature, for example. So there will be a much more, so you have to extend the notion of bilinear estimates, not just for the things that we've done here, but also things which involve curvature. Then we have to define the biometrics. So you can define the biometrics just like in the just like for the parasitic in flood case, except that U is replaced now by something much more complicated, which satisfies the Eilenberg equation. So you see immediately that if I take down a version of I, so this is our parametric, if I take down a version of this, then because of the Eilenberg equation, I generate only this type of terms. But this is not zero anymore. This would have been zero in Minkowski space, it's now not zero. Right? So this is your error term, in fact. This is what you have to control. And okay, so this now requires an additional where you have to estimate this Fourier integral operator. You have to get L2 estimates for this Fourier integral operator, but with very little control. Obviously, this is very unsmooth. Remember, this dimension of U is actually a trace car. Dimension of U exactly the trace chi of these non-hypersurfaces. So you have these non-hypersurfaces like this, with sigma t here. And chi is exactly the non-second fundamental form in the usual way. And trace chi is a trace of the non-second, there's the expansion going into it. So if you remember, and maybe I'll stop here because it doesn't make any sense to continue. But I just want to say one point. You see, if you remember from what we did last time, it was very important that trace chi is bounded in everything. In fact, chi hat, if you remember, chi hat and all the other components were only estimated in a trace norm. Right? You have an infinity only after you integrate in time. But this is a term that has to be in an infinity. And it's easy to see that if it was not in an infinity here, you have absolutely no chance of proving an estimate. Okay. So this is absolutely essential that everything we did for those non-hypersurfaces has to be used here when I consider the phase function and this dimensional view, which is trace time. And anyway, and then the main thing is to prove such estimates. I think it's better if I stop here and I'll continue with it. I think this is a good place to start because I can come back and review it next time, and I will also talk about the variance. So, let's start.